This is Thriller Forever, a video series chronicling every detail in the construction, release, and lasting impact of Michael Jackson's musical juggernaut. Even though Jackson didn't write Human Nature, the unencumbered emotion in his voice gives no doubt that Jackson found resonance in its lyrics. An outsider from his window looking onto a thrilling city, the singer fantasizes about stepping out and connecting with the life that surrounds him, yet appears to be out of reach. Michael Jackson attempts to take himself off the pedestal of fame and pursue a woman he is interested in. The yearning for freedom and authentic personal connection being universal.
I was raised on the stage, and that's where I'm comfortable. And everything else is like foreign to me. I'm just beginning to know and learn about people, friendship, and things like that.
However, Rob Temperton wasn't satisfied just writing the more frivolous pop tracks on the album and was inspired to write something more theatrical to suit Jackson's larger-than-life stage persona. Temperton improvised with bass and drum patterns until he developed the bass line that runs through the track. Then he wrote a chord progression that built to a climax. He recalled, quote, "I wanted it to build and build, a bit like stretching an elastic band throughout the tune to heighten suspense." Temperton's first version was titled Starlight, with the chorus lyric, quote, "Give me some starlight, Starlight Sun." Quincy felt that the song should be the album's title track, but felt Starlight was not strong enough of a title. Instead, they wanted something much more mysterious to match Jackson's evolving persona. Saying to the songwriter, quote, "You managed to come up with a title for the last album. See what you can do for this one." Temperton revealing, quote, "I went back to the hotel, wrote 200 or 300 titles, and came up with Midnight Man." Jones felt Temperton was going in the right direction, but still wasn't quite there yet. Quote, "The next morning I woke up and I just said this word. Something in my head just said this is the title. You could visualize it at the top of the Billboard charts. You could see the merchandising for this one word. How it jumped off the page as Thriller." With the title decided, Temperton wrote its lyrics within a couple of hours. Somehow, the British songwriter picked up on Jackson's love of horror movies and gave the lyrics a more ominous feel. The song found a balance between a Broadway-style narrative and a thumping, irresistible dance floor beat. Temperton envisioned a spoken word sequence for the ending, but did not know what form it should take. It was decided that it had to be performed by a famous voice from the horror genre, with Jones's then-wife suggesting her friend Vincent Price. Temperton composed the words for Price's part in a taxi on the way to the studio on the day of recording. Quote, "Rod wrote this brilliant Edgar Allan Poe spiel," said Jones, "and Vincent really understood it. Vincent did it in 2 takes. Incorporating sound effects such as creaking doors, thunder, footsteps, wind, and howling dogs, or more like Michael giving his best imitations, as soon as you hear the opening of Thriller, it's difficult not to conjure up visuals for its short film. But before its iconic imagery was burned into our collective consciousness, Thriller was just this catchy but kooky track in the middle of an otherwise mature album. For that reason, Thriller was not initially planned as a single, as Epic saw it being more of a novelty song. When asked, Walter Yetnikoff saying, quote, "Who wants a single about monsters?" However, after the album dropped from the top of Billboard 200 in the summer of 1983, having spent months at number one, the singer urged Yetnikoff to help conceive a plan to return the album to the top of the charts. Obsessive about his sales figures, Jackson's manager Frank DeLeo suggested releasing Thriller as a single, backed by a new music video. Quote, "It's simple. All you've got to do is dance, sing, and make it scary." After seeing the 1981 horror film An American Werewolf in London, Jackson contacted its director John Landis, a bold move as film directors had not worked on music videos before, but Landis was intrigued.
"I thought, I don't want to do a video. They're commercials to sell records, that's not my interest. And then I thought, well, wait a minute, it'd be fun to shoot a musical number correctly. I had hoped that to exploit his celebrity to bring back the theatrical short. And he was very enthusiastic about it, and I went home and I wrote a script that would be a two-reeler, and I brought it back, and he loved it. He said, though, the only difference was, he said, Can the zombies dance? Sure.
The director suggested they make a theatrical short on 35mm film with the production values of a feature film, rather than a standard music video. With a budget of $500,000, Thriller was going to be a much larger endeavor than any other music video before it. According to the director, when he called Walter Yetnikoff to propose the film, he swore so loudly Landis had to remove the phone from his ear. From the record label's perspective, they had little interest in making another video, believing that the album had already peaked. MTV, who benefited greatly from Jackson's earlier visual output, had a policy of not financing music videos, instead expecting record companies to pay for them in order to promote their artists. With Epic only contributing $100,000, Landis's producer George Folsey Jr. suggested a making of a documentary that, combined with the full-length video, would produce an hour-long film that could be sold to television to help finance its production. When the idea was proposed to networks, Showtime agreed to pay for half its budget, and MTV confirmed they would pay the rest, justifying their expenditure as financing a motion picture and not just a music video. Quote, "I wanted something that would glue you to the set, something you'd want to watch over and over," Michael wrote in his 1988 memoir. "I wanted to be a pioneer in this relatively new medium and make the best short music movies we could make." Thriller was even an event when it was being shot in October 1983. Marlon Brando, Fred Astaire, Rock Hudson, and Jackie Kennedy Onassis all turned up on set, and Eddie Murphy, Prince, and Diana Ross were spotted at its private premiere on the 14th of November. A week later, it was first shown to the public. To be eligible for the Oscars, it needed a week-long theatrical release, so Landis arranged for it to open bizarrely at Disney's Fantasia, at a single cinema in LA, though it was never nominated by the Academy. Then at midnight on 2nd of December, after weeks of trailers and media hype, MTV debuted Thriller to the world. The video opens with a disclaimer stating that Jackson in no way endorses supernatural practices, a decision made to help stem criticism from Michael's Jehovah's Witness faith. In the short film's extended prologue, Michael's moonlit date with his girlfriend, played by model Ola Ray, is cut short when their car breaks down. And while walking to get help, Jackson is transformed into a howling creature and attacks his date. The real Michael and Ola observe the scene in a movie theater and decide to leave after she gets spooked. Michael continues to tease her as they walk through empty streets, and nearby, a horde of zombies rise from their graves, threatening the couple. To Ola's horror, Michael transforms into one of them himself and leads the troop of zombies into a choreographed dance routine. Afterwards, Michael and the other zombies corner Ola in an abandoned house, only for her to realize it was all a nightmare. Though Michael offers a last, beast-eyed glance at the camera before the credits roll. While the music video has plenty of visual elements that have since become iconic, particularly Jackson's red moto-style jacket and matching pants, the Thriller dance sequence, developed by choreographer Michael Peters, is one of the most distinctive and imitated choreographies of all time. Dancer Vincent Patterson was asked to train Jackson and the other dancers for 4 days before they filmed, as well as appear as a zombie in the video himself. Quote, "I thought Peters hit the target immediately," Patterson recalls. "It was technical to a point. You couldn't be too technical with Michael Jackson. He wasn't an extremely trained dancer, but he could pick up things very, very well." Other iconic scenes in the music video included Michael's various terrifying metamorphoses. Inspired by American Werewolf in London, Jackson initially wanted to be transformed into a four-legged beast. However, this idea was soon replaced with a two-legged monster so Michael could still dance. John Landis suggested that Jackson should become a werewolf in a 1950s setting, inspired by the 1957 film, I Was a Teenage Werewolf. However, special effects makeup artist Rick Baker decided to instead turn Jackson into a werecat. Quote, "because I just didn't want to do another werewolf," he said.
"And I discovered he really just wanted to turn into a monster. That was his desire. He loved it. And we showed him all these photos of monsters from different movies, learned he'd never seen any of these movies. I mean, he knew Bride of Frankenstein was like, and King Kong, it was like it. He had never seen anything. But he wanted to turn into the werewolf like David Naughton did, David was four-footed. It turned into a what? And I said, Mike, if you're going to dance, it'll be hard with 4 feet. I said, let's, you know, do like I was a teenage werewolf, Michael Landon, which is why he's wearing a Letterman's jacket. It's a 50s thing. And Rick eventually created that kind of leonine, sort of a cat monster, werecat thing, who's kind of elegant, you know.
Initially envisioning a werecat that would resemble a Black Panther, Rick eventually added a longer mane and larger ears. According to Landis, the production involved the largest makeup team in film history up to that point, with 40 artists making up Jackson, dancers, and other extras into terrifying depictions of the undead. During its development, John Landis insisted that Jackson's transformations couldn't be too unattractive, but Baker was amused at how into the idea of turning into a monster Michael was. Quote, I thought he's like a rock star. I don't think he's going to want to wear this makeup. But it turned out that's what he wanted to do more than anything, Baker recalled.
But you also did personal makeups for Michael, too, after that.
I didn't.
Never?
No. No. He wanted me to make pieces for him, disguise pieces and stuff, right, so he could go out. But he wanted to put them on himself. And I really felt we couldn't do what he really wanted, and he couldn't put it on in a way. Mm-hmm. I remember there was a picture in the National Enquirer of Michael with a Afro wig on and his face painted gray, and it said it was a $10,000 makeup by, you know, makeup artist Rick Baker, you know.
Great, nice commercial.
Yeah, you know, and that's exactly why I didn't want to do it, you know.
After the video premiere and the Making Michael Jackson's Thriller documentary was released on VHS, it attracted more than 100,000 advance orders, going on to sell nearly 10 million copies and winning a Grammy for Best Video Album in 1985. The video's success also doubled the already sensational numbers in album sales. Thriller would go on to receive 3 MTV Video Music Awards for Best Overall Performance in a Video, Best Choreography in a Video, and Viewer's Choice, as well as a People's Choice Award for Favorite Video of the Year. The song had been certified Diamond, selling over 10 million units, and Thriller continues to chart every Halloween season, reaching number 1 on 3 different Billboard charts the week of November 8, 2023, some 40 years after its initial release. Another Rob Temperton track that made it onto Thriller, one of the only two that wasn't released as a single, was The Lady in My Life. Chosen to close the record out, the classic Sinatra-style ballad provides a finale full of grace and dripping with old-school soul. Michael wasn't a stranger to a ballad, but this wasn't some love song about a rat. Quincy Jones wanted to challenge Michael to perform something with much more soul and depth to it. The Lady in My Life isn't recounting an innocent crush or the bubbling excitement of a new romance. It's much more mature and committed with its intention. Quote, we were used to doing a lot of takes in order to get the vocal as nearly perfect as possible, but Quincy wasn't satisfied with my work on that song, Michael Jackson remembered. Finally, he took me aside late one session and told me he wanted me to beg. That's what he said. He wanted me to go back to the studio and literally beg for it. Therefore, Michael went into the studio and had them turn off the lights and close the curtains so not to feel self-conscious. Quincy started the tape and Jackson begged profusely, and the result is what you can hear on the record today. Described as the closest Jackson has come to crooning a sexy, soulful ballad after his Motown years, The Lady in My Life is another slice of perfect production. Seductive and smooth, the song slowly builds with Jackson's sublimely pure vocals and enticing melodies. Originally recorded with extra verses, timing constraints on vinyl forced the song to be trimmed back. Sacrificed was more than 2 minutes of Jackson's ad-libs in an extended outro that showcases his brilliance as a natural vocalist. Never to be performed live, nor did it receive a video, the track remains a mysterious glimmer of Jackson's undefinable magic. Through the pulsating beats and electrifying melodies of Thriller, Michael Jackson truly transcended the boundaries of music to create a timeless masterpiece that still resonates with audiences across the globe. Its success gave Jackson an unprecedented level of cultural power never previously achieved by a Black artist, leading him to being honored by the president at the White House as the most significant entertainer of a generation. Thriller was the first album to spend 37 non-consecutive weeks at number 1 on the Billboard 200. Conquering the Grammys in 1984, winning a record-breaking 8 awards including Album of the Year, a space and time when Jackson's unparalleled talent and creative vision single-handedly ignited a revolution in music, forever altering the landscape of popular culture. Greatness that cannot be replicated ever again in quite the same way, but can still inspire those brave enough to meet the standard Michael Jackson set all those years ago, whether yesterday, today, or forevermore.